That's just me. All right, now let's talk about customers. Customers are the human beings that walk into your shop and give you money and you become rich. We all want customers, isn't it? All of us, when we wake up in the morning, we're like lions. Customers are like springboks. We're chasing them, they're running away from us. Isn't it? Yeah. So in Africa, either they spring back or... Now, here's the thing, guys. What customers want is this thing. They want value. Okay? If you can give me value, I will not question how much it costs. If you can give me value, I'll never question how much it costs. But when I ask you a question about the cost, then the value is not visible. Does it make sense? It's like when you go to a... When you go to the Ritz-Carlton, if you ask, you can't afford the Ritz-Carlton. You understand? If you go to Formula One, or whatever it's called now, you will ask, they didn't deliver the soap, you know, because it's a one-star hotel or a no-star hotel. So, you know, when you book, they say, do you bring your own mattress or not your mattress? You know, those kind of things. So customers want value. Now, in your business, you have to define who your customers are. Okay? Now, I'm going to start at the bottom. At the bottom, we have what we call dogs. You know, literally dogs. It's fascinating, isn't it? This is marketing speak. Now, who are dogs? Dogs are the customers that demand the most and pay you the least, but they have influence. They are going to irritate you. They are going to call you 7 times. They're going to want to discount and this and this. Hey, it's a mess, but they have influence. But not all of them have influence. You have to know that this one has influence. Therefore, I'm willing to slog it out with this person. You understand what I'm trying to say? You will have this kind of customers, but the magic is you've got to recognize that this person falls in the category of dogs. Then you've got these ones here. The cash cows. Now, the cash cows are your cash flow people. These are the customers that come by, give you money, end of story. You understand? They don't ask. They're not funny. They just come and they want their thing and that's it. And, you know, these are the customers that say, Mr. Selkani, we've got a conference and such a date. Please give us your bank account. We'll pay you now. I ask them, what is the theme? They say, no, you're a man of wisdom. We just have 5 issues in our business. People are not working together as teams. There's lethargy. Productivity has gone very low. There's issues of morale. And we think our leaders are not very enlightened. They tell me those 5 things. And they say to me, you know what to do. I love those kind of customers. You understand? Isn't it that that's all we want? Oh my God, we go and we pray. May I get cash customers? May I get the cash cows? And then you've got your B customers. Now your B customers are the guys that will always buy bulk from you at one specific time and not buy for a very long time. You understand? So for me, it's the kind of client that says, we have a roadshow, 18 roadshows, this province, that province, that province. We do the roadshow, we get excited, and they say, we'll see you next year. They literally tell me, we'll see you next year. So it means I must not bother them during the year. You understand? Because that's the relationship. That's how it works. If I want to communicate with them, I must give them something of value according to them, not according to me. Because what you think is valuable might not be valuable to the next person. So that's why it's important for you to research your customers. Who are they? Again, we'll go back to the avatar. You know what I'm trying to say? And then there's your A-listers. You know, this is the A-list. Now, these are big customers. These are blue-chip customers. These are customers where the sales cycle is much longer than it is in other customers, but the deal is worth it. You understand what I'm trying to say? There's a guy I give a proposal to. They say, change there, change there, change there, change there. These are the guys that don't care how much you charge them because they want value, because they know you can deliver value. Now, you've got to say to yourself, if this is your list of customers, you then have to split them according to percentages. Okay? Where am I going to find these customers? Where do I look for them? How do I deal with them? Again, goes back to the avatar issue. So you've got to say to yourself, these guys, I don't have to worry, but I need them. So you have to decide. Maybe they must make up 15% of your business. Okay, what does it leave you? It leaves you with 85%, isn't it? Now, this is strategic thinking. Because if you don't think strategically about your customers, then you don't understand business. Pick and pay. Don't be excited being by listed in Pick and Pay because they're going to pay you in 120 days. Do you know that? You understand? Don't be excited about it because they're gonna, you know, I'm not excited about my book being in bookshops like exclusive whatever because they're not going to pay me. I like it when I sell my own book because I make all the money. You understand? So you've got to know these things. And I go to customers and I hear that these guys, they want me to come and speak. They've got 1,500 people or whatever. I say, okay, buy all my books and I'll come for free. They say, yeah, exciting. Because they think of the one unit, 150 book, but multiply that by 1,500. Kitchen for me. You understand? So you've got to have a strategic methodology that you use to sift through your customers and decide who your customers are. And by the way, learn to say no. You don't say yes to everything. And some people tell them why you say no. And some others you have to dodge them, you know. Don't tell them. So it leaves you with your 85%. Now, if you take 30% and say, those are going to be my cash cows, okay? So now 35% of your strategy is allocated in these two. How much does it leave you with? 65, okay? So you say 65%. Of these customers. Now, out of these two, where do I really want to spend a lot of energy because it will give me a long-term return? Okay, I would take 40% and put it here. And the 15% here because these guys, no, the 25% here. Because these guys, they buy big. I can use them as my cash flow when these guys don't show up as much as I want to show up. But this is where I know it's a 5 million, 10 million deal. It's not a one-year deal. It's a multi-year deal. Okay? And then you say to yourself, you've got a 10-year strategy, you know, of your business. Then you say, okay, these guys, my guys, this 40%, how is it going to be split through my 10 years? So you've got 2 years, 4, 6, 8, 10, you know, 6, 8, 10, okay? So you say to yourself, if I take this 40%, and I'm saying out of the 40% customers, I need to make 20 million. Okay, how are you going to split this million? Is it 5 million per customer, or is it two customers, 10 million each? You understand what I'm saying? And once you've done this, now you go deeper in defining exactly who these people are. Where do you find them? Because the way you talk to this person is not the way you talk to this person. It's not the way you talk to this person. It's not the way you talk to this person. Here, you're going to have to do a dinner. You're going to have to play golf. You understand what I'm trying to say? You understand? Here, probably here, you're going to have to give them some specials. Because these guys show up all the time. And they give you cash. You're going to discount them and do this kind of thing. The staff, here you can say a percentage of discount, a percentage of trade exchange, depending on what industry they're in. You understand? But these things don't happen accidentally. They happen intentionally. Does it make sense? You sit down and say, guys, we're doing our customer strategy. You do it proper. You do proper research. Which customers? Like you're gonna say, you know, if you're gonna be dealing, some of you are gonna deal with government, you can't avoid it. You've got national, you've got province, you've got local municipality. Again, you're gonna look at your risk. So for whatever customer that you're working with, you have to do a risk management strategy. You know, if I have two customers that are all giving me 10 million in 2 years, what is the big risk? The big risk is the CEO gets fired, the person that signed the contract shifts and moves jobs, will my contract still be valid? You know, you've got to do all those kind of risks. You understand? Because I've had a time in my life where one of my customers bought 85% of my time. But I became clever. When they said to me, when they start asking you a question, don't get excited. Because if you're excited, they see that you're an amateur. So this guy looks at me and says, listen, we love what you do for us. I need 85% of your time. How much is it? If you give me an answer there and there, you're not good. You're not getting it. I say, I'm going to get back to you because I'm going to have to look at variables. I'm going to have to look at my local business, my international business. I would look at all of this, then I'll give you a number. Then I come back and I give him a number. Then he gets excited and says, by the way, I need to release myself from other contracts, so I need a sign-on fee. You sign me on. And the sign-on fee goes in immediately in my account. You understand? You now, this is here. It's not in any of these levels. You know? And I had that deal for 5 years. And one day it just stopped. You don't understand what that means. The Twin Towers. You know. And it stops without recourse. You know, it means it stops and that's the end of the story. You know? And now here's one of the things that you guys must understand. So I'm in America, in Atlanta. We're sitting down, having a drink, and we're talking. So there's this friend of mine, he's based in the UK, he's a speaker, but he's a lawyer. So he's a top contract lawyer. So people that do big contracts, they go to him, you know, he's a very good negotiator of contract. So we talk about contracts. So he says, okay, how do you do your contracts? Everybody says, I do my contract like this, like this. So you, I said, no, I don't do contracts. At that time, I did not do contracts. He says, so how do you run your business? I said, it's very simple. I run it on faith. I look at the man in the face, I shake the hand, and I send the invoice and I do the work. And this guy says to me, one day, when you need a contract and you have lost a lot of money, go and buy an expensive bottle of whiskey and drink it on my behalf. Now, when this happened, this was a handshake deal. So this business was paying me over $1 million a year on a handshake between me and the CEO. And when things became bad, there was no piece of paper that said, this is the contract, this is the exit clause, this is the cancellation clause, nothing. And I went and I bought an expensive bottle of whiskey. And I drank it on his behalf. So, what am I saying? Contract management is important. It's important. I have a contract. You want me to speak for a day? I'll still send a contract. You sign my contract. My contract is clear. You cancel 50%. I show up. I speak for an hour. If your conference is 15 minutes late, I speak for 45 minutes. If it's 30 minutes late, I speak for 30 minutes. If it's 30 minutes late, I speak for 30 minutes. If it's 45 minutes late, I speak for 15 minutes. If it's 1 hour late, I don't speak. I leave and you still pay me. Yes. When the, what do you call this thing, the load shedding used to happen, I had a clause that said, I'm not involved with load shedding. If there's a load shedding, I still get paid. It's your business. Make sure there's a generator that runs when I'm speaking. I can speak in darkness. Well, they will not see me, but they'll hear me, you know, because I'm very dark, you know, but and I'll try and smile as much as I can so that they can see that I'm still there, you know. But you must, guys, contracts, I'm telling you now, most of you do handshake deals. I know. Mama, send me an invoice, send me a quotation, send me this, yeah, I know you've got the job. Yes, when the email says you've got the job, it can be treated as a contract, but man, you need a lot of money to go to court to prove that that email was sent in this, you know. So get your contracts, and the way that you deal with all these customers, guys, is completely different. Now we're moving towards December, get it? And people give each other gifts and all kind of things. Now you're going to see, you ask yourself, who do I give? What do I give this person? Don't buy them little puppies, please. Buy. These are dogs. I'm going to buy them little puppies. What do I give to this? What do I give to this? Who do I go out for dinner, for lunch, for whatever? All right. And therefore it says, when you create a communication or a marketing or whatever, each message that goes here is not the same that goes here, is not the same that goes here. And so goes the story. Does it make sense? For me, on my 8 clients, I've got local clients, international clients, I've got guy energy, whatever, and I treat them all in a different way. So you, as your business, you've got to do the same thing. You, madam, with the hip and the body stuff like that, you've got to decide here. So you've got to think, am I going to go and sell to Etihad? Can I sell to Etihad? Can I sell to Qatar? Can I sell to Malawi on air, whatever? You know what I mean? You've got to think, but you've got to categorize your client very clearly. Create a strategy for each and every client and take all of this, which we're going to now go to the money side, and take all of this and quantify it based on the value of your business. Okay, and I say to people, minimum 5-year plan. You must have a 100-year plan, quite honestly. Yes, you must have a 100-year plan for your business. She's surprised. Yes, 100 years from now, you won't be there. What's going to be happening to your business? Will it go with you like these puzzle shops allocation in Texas? All right, any questions on customers? Yes, sir.
When I think about funnels, you know,
exactly.
Yes,
so you create different funnels. So
the funnel pair.
Yeah. And because when you create a funnel, it means everything. How you communicate, when you communicate, what do you give, who do you connect them with, and those kind of things, you know. Because some of my A-listers, a friend of mine will come. There's a friend of mine who they've created a fantastic technology. He's very good at pitching that technology. So I ask myself, okay, if I send him to my 8 line, do I go with him or do I let him do his own thing? If I go with him, his pitch is going to die because the client is very hooked with me. I send him on his own. He closes the deal on his own. He gives me what's due to me, and end of story. You understand what I'm trying to say? And then I get agents, you know, an agent phones me and says, listen, this customer, he wants, you know, 30 keynotes. Are you willing to deal with him? And usually we talk when we get to an understanding. I don't do this thing called discount. We just talk and get to an understanding. You understand? I always, my value is not negotiable. Does it make sense? So your sales funnel are then specific. When you create campaigns, you don't create a campaign like Utsela Mitsiko Strateng, you know, and hope some other seller somebody. No. You specific. You speak into this customer, to that customer, to that customer, to that customer. Does it make sense? Any questions? Now let's take one business and do this quickly with it. And do this exercise quickly with it.
Okay, ma'am. Before, with regards to the dots, because you said there's two types. I'm thinking
this. One with influence, the one with no influence.
Yeah.
You've got to know.
But how would you distinguish between the two? Because sometimes they might both have influence. They can both have influence, but the other one doesn't realize.
Then you help them realize they've got influence.
And then they become the problem.
Those are the ones that you send your branded materials to.
Yeah, let me give an example. A person is a DG of a department. Go and research their history. Where do they come from before they become a DG? If they've been DGs in four different departments, what is their track record in those four departments? So most of you guys, unfortunately, don't do research. And you think research is expensive. No, research is not expensive. You go online, you go to whatever. It's not expensive. You go to their website, you go and check. It's not. We're building a technology. Actually, it's been built. We're trying to get the technology where I can get to five generations of your social media influence. Where I can go to your Facebook, send an email. After I get your email, the technology will go through your Facebook and give me your profile and five generations, your five closest big number people. Who are they? Who do they talk to? What influence they have? Then I can retarget those people through you. Same thing Facebook is doing. It's very good at that. You've got to learn for big business. You've got to think big but work small, you know? You understand? You've got to research your customers, guys. And by the way, I don't believe there's a big deal behind a small deal. A small deal is a small deal. If it has to be big, it will be big. You know, I remember somebody says to me, "Oh, no, we're having a conference. We've got CEOs from this country and that country and that country. Please, Mr. Zelkana, come and speak, and then they will see you from these other countries. Maybe they will use you." I say, by the way, maybe those people that are coming here will ask you about me. They know me. So if someone's come and talk, and they will know me, you know, it doesn't make sense. I don't do that.